I won't say much to start because it is about the papers, of course, the scientific papers, and but just want to share a couple of thoughts that I have. And one is a line that I saw, which I just want to read for you. We will serve the public interest by ensuring that where there is uncertainty of future financial outcomes, actuaries are trusted and sought after for their valued analysis and authority. Do you recognize that? It is part of your vision. It's the vision of the British actuarial profession, and it is what struck me is it is serving public interest, and I think that is what we should keep in mind, and that is what when I speak for myself, easily is forgotten when we go to the mathematics of all kinds of difficult things, and that is also today the case. I think there's a lot of mathematics, and that is important and necessary, but we should never forget we do it for the public interest. We do it for human beings, for the members, for sponsors, etc. in society. And that is, in my view, and that is a very personal view, also the purpose of the holistic balance sheet, to get all the building blocks of the financial position of a pension fund right and transparent and be able to communicate about it. And in my view, hopefully, it is less about asking for more money in pension funds. It is just not doable when I see some figures floating around. But it is more about communication between stakeholders, in my view. But I would like to have your perspective as well on that later on when there is room for discussion. I will stick to that. It is not nice to be in this, Royal Society of Medicine. We are like medical doctors, I think, highly technical people, but always dealing with people, human people. And we are now learning more about medicine for pensions, I think. And I would like to invite Craig Turnbull to, give your presentation and take the floor.
Good evening, everybody. Okay, so I've tried to condense my rather long paper into a handful of slides to try to present some of its key findings to you this evening. So it wasn't easy, but hopefully I can at least bring out some of the salient points over the next few minutes that we can then discuss more widely during the course of the discussion this evening. In terms of setting the scene, I think we'll all be aware of what makes this such an interesting topic for everyone here this evening. But a few sort of statistics and observations to make that I think make this a particularly interesting topic at this time. Clearly in the UK we live in interesting economic times where defined benefit pension fund deficits are at very challenging and high levels, exacerbated by the current exceptionally low interest rate environment. That naturally makes the idea of sponsor commitment to improving the funding position of pension funds and the idea of a sponsor covenant particularly important for pension fund members and the security of their promised benefits. And we can put that sort of status, if you like, of the defined benefit pension funding alongside some of the developments we've seen elsewhere in actuarial practice, particularly over the last 10 years, where in the insurance side, which is actually where I've spent most of my time, we've seen something of a revolution, if you like, in terms of how risk and capital and values are calculated, and in particular, the application of quantitative tools and market-based, risk-based methods therein. And we can see those two strands really coming together somewhat in some of the ideas behind the holistic balance sheet and the proposals and the quiz that have been released by IORPs. In the paper, I try to address three broad questions. Firstly, if we think about the idea of a market-consistent valuation for the assets and liabilities of a defined benefit fund, How do we go about calculating those valuations? And in particular, how do we approach the market consistent valuation of this sponsor covenant asset? Secondly, assuming that those first calculations are ultimately somewhat complex, are there actually some shortcuts we can take to approximating those sort of so-called full valuations in a way which is pragmatic for potentially thousands of pension funds? And then thirdly, once we have this idea of a holistic or market-consistent balance sheet, can we use it as a risk-based capital measure in an analogous way to how the global insurance sector has used market-consistent balance sheets and the idea of value at risk based on that balance sheet to assess prudential capital, if you like, and funding adequacy for promised benefits? So those were the three sort of themes that we try to address over the course of the paper. As I say, over the next few slides, I'll just sort of dip into some of them and give you an idea of what we're trying to say. Firstly, so this idea of holistic balance sheet, in its absolutely simplest form then, is trying to capture the fact that over and above the current funding of the assets of the pension fund, there is this additional layer of value, if you like, which can be considered as an asset in the pension fund balance sheet, which reflects the sponsor's ability and commitment to make good in the current deficit in future years to come. If we think about each of those items of the balance sheet and the placing, if you like, of a market value on those items, then we can think about them in turn. Firstly, for the asset portfolio, well, there's nothing new there, if you like, in terms of putting a market value on a reasonably liquid set of assets. So that's not something that we address in the paper. The market consistent valuation of the liability side of the balance sheet is an interesting topic. In principle, putting a market-based value on a set of fixed cash flows or even inflation-linked cash flows is theoretically a straightforward process. But one of the things that we've learned in Solvency II over the last five or so years is that there's a lot of complexity involved, and particularly valuing very illiquid, very long-term fixed cash flows. So in particular, thinking about topics like illiquidity premiums, yield curve extrapolation, and so on, there are a bunch of interesting questions in there, even once you've resolved that a guaranteed cash flow should be valued using a risk-free interest rate. Again, that's not something we really address in the paper, but it, I think, is a natural research strand that overlaps with the interests and interests of insurance actuaries today. Finally, the main focus of the paper is this third topic, which is placing the market-consistent value in the sponsor covenant. So in the paper, we really define this idea of a covenant as the sponsor's commitment to making future deficit funding contributions that are required over the lifetime of the pension liabilities. And the complexity in the valuation of the covenant primarily arises from the credit risk of the sponsor and the possibility that the sponsor may essentially go bankrupt prior to funding the deficit in the pension fund. And as it happens, placing a market value on that risk can be a fairly complex problem in general, because the contribution commitment can be very long term, i.e. the sponsor is not committing to making good in the deficit tomorrow, he's proposing to do so potentially over coming decades, and that commitment is credit risky. The nature of the commitment may also be quite dynamic and path dependent, so the deficit contributions in 2018 will be higher if the deficit is greater in that year than otherwise. The nature of the sponsor credit risk will often be correlated with the size of the deficit. So the same economic exposures that can drive poor asset performance in the pension fund can also increase the probability of default on the sponsor. And observing a sort of market-based or market-implied cost for bearing that sponsor risk itself is something that might not be directly observable in financial markets. So, for those reasons and others, creating this market-based valuation for the sponsor covenant is in general not a straightforward problem. But we describe in the paper how we can go about thinking about that problem and developing a framework to answer that question. So firstly, in order to value the sponsor covenant, we have to make assumptions about the behavior of these additional deficit funding sponsor contributions. In particular, you know, the timing and the nature of them in terms of how they're calculated and when they're paid into the pension fund. The timing is absolutely crucial because the longer the sort of funding of the deficit is deferred, the greater, in theory, the greater the exposure to sponsor credit risk. So that's something that we will see in the examples, is that timing is critical to the valuation of the sponsor covenant, particularly for very credit risky sponsors. So we need a rule there, some sort of algorithm, if you like, that describes how that contribution will be set and how it will behave under different circumstances in the future as the pension fund runs off. Once we have that sort of description of what the cash flow stream looks like, we then can go about creating this market consistent valuation. And the key thing in the market consistent valuation is really about understanding, as I say, when the sponsor won't be able to make good in the commitment and what happens in that event. So that can be sort of categorized or represented by these three questions that we have to answer when thinking about this valuation. Firstly, we have to determine in what circumstances will the sponsor be assumed to be unable to make good in on their commitment. And in our example, we assume this is simply equal to the event of the corporate going into the corporate sponsor defaulting. So then and only then do we assume the sponsor doesn't make good in their commitment. And then we have to assume what the size of the pension fund deficit is when that sponsor default occurs. And in our approach, we actually model that stochastically. And then finally, we have to make an assumption about what happens when default does occur, and how much can be recovered, if anything, from the sponsor in that circumstance. And again, in our work here, we make some assumptions there that essentially treats or assumes that in our examples, that the pension fund is treated essentially like an unsecured creditor for the sponsor. But again, that can be something that can be generalized. Once we have made all of those assumptions, we'll then have a framework to then value the cash flows implied by that model. And the key point here is that the valuation exercise here is intended to produce something that we think of as market consistent. It's intended to reflect what we think a market-based approach to valuing this credit risky set of cash flows would be. And the main place that we go to establish that market consistent basis is the corporate bond prices of the sponsor. So what we're trying to assess here is, you know, what the market-based estimate of the cost of being exposed to the default risk the pension fund bears currently is at any point in time. An important point to note there is that because we're interested in that market consistent valuation, in our modeling, we don't need to make any assumptions about our own sort of best estimates of the default probabilities of the sponsor. All we need to observe is what the market charges, if you like, for being exposed to that risk. So that's a sort of general result that we see again in insurance when it comes to creating market consistent balance sheets there. Because we're interested in a market-based estimate, our own estimates of some of these probabilities aren't important. All that's important is that we can observe what the market is charging for the exposures we're trying to be consistent with. So in order to capture all these sort of variables, we've developed a sort of stochastic modeling approach, a stochastic simulation approach, which can allow us to project forward a bunch of economic variables, such as how interest rates and equity markets and so on behave, in order to capture how the pension fund's assets and liabilities will behave over time, what that then means for the contribution stream that's produced, and also what that means for sponsor default behavior through the projection of the business through time. And again, using market consistent techniques, once we've developed and calibrated that model to market prices, we can then essentially obtain this sponsor covenant market consistent valuation. So to bring that to life a little bit, I'll show you a sort of quick example that we develop in the paper. We start with a set of liability promised cash flows in the left-hand chart there, which will roll off over the next 60 years. And when those are valued using a government bond yield at the end of 2011, those present value conveniently to exactly $1 billion. We then assume that the asset portfolio of the scheme today is currently $800 million, and we consider two sort of very extreme different contribution strategies for funding the deficit. The first one, which goes to sort of theoretical limit of how long we can defer making these contributions, by saying that we only make contributions into the scheme once the asset portfolio has been exhausted by the liability cash flow outflows. And the second one, which really looks at a reasonably extreme position in the other direction, which says annually we'll make a contribution that's equal to whatever the market consistent deficit of the scheme is divided by five. So we can start to then run our model and understand what these values look like. We can start with the very simple case where we assume the sponsor is risk-free. And in that case, generally, if we have a risk-free sponsor, we'd generally expect that the value in a market-consistent basis of these contributions should basically be whatever the deficit is today, whatever the difference in assets and liabilities is today. So in this example, it would be $200 million. And that's what we find here when we assume with that first contribution strategy, where we defer contributions for as long as possible with a risk-free asset portfolio. Interestingly, as we turn on asset risk here, moving to a very risky portfolio, or even one that's 50-50, risk-free and risky, we find that the covenant valuation increases. And similarly, with the second contribution strategy, we see that result again, even more so. So that might look a bit of a puzzling result, that we're producing covenant valuations well in excess of the size of the deficit today. This is basically reflecting a sort of optionality that's in these investment and contribution strategies and the possibility to create for some terminal surplus assets to be there in the scheme. So under these asset strategies, we might find that actually we've made more contributions than we need to. And at the end of the day, we could have a surplus pool of assets. So depending on where we put those assets, that will either increase the covenant valuation or not. So if we assumed, for example, that the sponsor could recover those surplus assets back in the event they arise, that would reduce these valuations back. And in all these cases, we'd get a £200 million result. But I haven't done that in this analysis. We've just assumed that those are sort of orphan assets, if you like. And so that creates a sort of an option or a surplus valuation. Into the more interesting case where we turn on the sponsor default risk, in general what we find is that the sponsor covenant valuation basically has three components. You can see it as the current size of the deficit on a market consistent basis, plus the sort of terminal surplus asset value that I just described, less the sponsor default risk that we are valuing using the simulation model that captures the market-based default risk and its correlation with the assets of the portfolio. And we can then use that to produce a whole bunch of different results for the covenant valuation. Key things just to sort of bring out of these charts. Firstly, as you'd expect, as we sort of turn the sponsor's credit rating down through the spectrum, we get quite a significant drop in the value of the covenant. Because we're assuming that some recovery can be made even in the case of an immediate default, we find that the covenant valuation is never zero in these examples, but falls to 35% in this case of the current deficit. You can see as we move from that contribution strategy one to strategy two, where we're basically assuming that much more of the deficit is funded much sooner, that generally increases the value of the covenant because it reduces the exposure to sponsor default risk and therefore increases the value of the market consistent value of the commitment. Okay, finally, I'd just like to touch on this idea of using the market consistent balance sheet as a risk-based solvency measure. Because again, I think this has been really, certainly in the insurance context, and I think similarly in the IORPA proposals, the market consistent balance sheet or the holistic balance sheet is really only a means to an end. And that end is ultimately understanding security of benefits by using the market consistent balance sheet to assess sort of capital adequacy. And in that context, the capital adequacy is measured using this idea of a one-year value at risk, which is looking at how the sort of net assets of the market consistent balance sheet can behave over a one-year horizon, and in particular, in a 99.5th percentile tail of that distribution of net assets, what that level of capital would be to absorb that loss. So if we take that as an example, we can go about implementing in a fairly simple way a one-year value at risk. As a side note, there's all sorts of much more sophisticated ways of implementing value at risk in a sort of rigorous way, which are being explored in insurance. But for this simple example, we simply do a series of stress tests of the balance sheet to each of the risks, the key risks that drive the balance sheet, and understand the losses created for the balance sheet at that 99.5th percentile level, and then basically sum them up using a correlation matrix. And we make a bunch of different assumptions about what those stress tests look like for the key four different sort of financial market risks that drive, for example, balance sheets. So the details of this are all in the paper, but it's the interest of time we run through this. So when we do that, we can then basically establish what the capital levels are that are created by each of these risks for different sort of example sponsors. In this case, we're looking at an A-rated and double B-rated sponsor, and then finally create a total sort of balance sheet that includes that solvency capital requirement, if you like. So if you just run through these numbers quickly, we're looking at three different sponsors here: risk-free, A-rated, and double B-rated sponsor. In all cases, the starting asset portfolio is 800 million. In all cases, the promised liability is equal to 1 billion. And in the previous results on the valuation, we found we obtained these results here for the value of the sponsor covenant, and this is under contribution strategy 2. So for risk-free sponsor rate 345, and that falls significantly as we put the sponsor down the credit spectrum. So that knocks on to the sort of current value of the assets of the balance sheet. And hence, starting net assets of the balance sheet are 145 for the risk-free sponsor, 7 and minus 45 in the double B case. By then stressing these net asset values and understanding how each of these items of the balance sheet change on each of these stress tests, and then summing those requirements, we then obtain this sort of solvency capital requirement number. And the risk-free sponsor, this number is 0, because basically any change in the assets or liabilities under stress are offset by an exact offsetting impact for the sponsor covenant in the risk-free case. But as we move down the credit spectrum, the ability of the sponsor covenant to act as that sort of loss absorber or shock absorber under stress is diminished, and that ultimately produces higher and higher sort of solvency capital requirements. So the idea here is that what this allows us to do is then to produce, if you like, a capital requirement for the pension fund that incorporates the sponsor's ongoing commitments and reflects the credit risk of the sponsor in doing so. And in these cases, you see that in both the credit risky cases, in this stylized example, the solvency capital requirement is 12 to 18% of the market consistent liability value, so a fairly significant margin. So I think there's a number of interesting places that this can be taken next. As I mentioned, producing techniques to approximate that market consistent valuation so we don't have to use a full-blown Monte Carlo simulation technique is a natural area, one that we do briefly touch on in the paper. The analysis here hasn't considered at all the role that pension protection plans play here on the balance sheet and its behavior. I think that's an interesting, potentially complex area that this research could be extended into. And as I mentioned finally as well, even with the covenant, just looking at the actual valuation of the core promised cash flows on the liability side is an area which is causing a huge amount of discussion and research on the insurance side, which I think has clearly got similar significant implications for the sort of financial health and numbers that are produced by this type of analysis here. Pass over any questions.
Thank you so much, Greg. There is some time for technical questions. So I'm not going to get a full discussion. We leave that for after the second presentation. But are there any questions to clarify what Greg has presented?
Yep, John.
And so the kind of loss given default isn't necessarily a jump. But when you're dealing with a corporate sponsor, who's, let's say, not a financial institution, you can have a jump to default. So when you take your kind of double B case or a lower grade case, mm-hmm. you've kind of had a probability distribution to look at the solvency margin down below, so the 122. But then you've kind of taken at the top end on an assumption of kind of, say, a 3% default rate or something to bill or whatever default rate happens to be. But the reality is they'll jump to default. So you kind of don't have this probability distribution. Your 99.5% is default. And you need to reflect that both at the top and the bottom, don't you?
Yeah, let me just... So I'll just jump back a slide or two to this. I briefly refer to this. So you're absolutely right. So I think there's two levels to this in terms of modelling the sponsor default. One is in the valuation, the market consistent valuation itself, we'll have a model which says the probability of them defaulting in each year looks like this, and we'll correlate that to equity markets and so on. And those default probabilities will actually be derived from market prices and will be basically be risk neutral. But we will be capturing that jump in the sense that it will either be have defaulted or won't, but we'll model it using a ratings-based approach, so it will gradually, more often than not, it will go single A to single B and then default the year after. It won't normally jump immediately, but there'll be a ratings matrix, basically, that's derived from corporate bond spreads we'll use to do that exercise. But then in the solvency piece, which I think was the piece you were mentioning, yeah, we then have to make an estimate of what the 99.5th percentile one-year change in the rating is. And again, we can use a sort of ratings matrix to make an estimate of that. So in an example here, for a sponsor that's A-rated, if we look at a typical sort of long-term ratings transition matrix, a 99.5th percentile change in rating for an A-rated sponsor over 1 year would be down to double B. So for the A-rated sponsor, that's what we assume in that stress, is that it's a double B sponsor but at the end of the year. Whereas for a double B sponsor today, the 99.5th stress would actually be to default. So in that case, we're actually assuming they do default at the end of the year, and so the solvency capital has to reflect that. So that basically means that on that solvency basis, you're basically assuming that the sponsor has defaulted.
If you look at the BB rated sponsor, they've got 800 assets. The covenant value of 155 in the scenario should jump to zero in default. Let's just say there's no recovery. If you have a recovery.
Yeah, and this we've got a 35% recovery rate in this analysis.
Okay, so you take the 155, yeah. Add it to the 175, and in this case, 30% of that doesn't really cover the gap from 800 to.
Exactly, so basically, of the 175 here, a big chunk of that is because of the stress test where the 155 falls to, a much smaller number when it's assumed to default. That's right. So there's much more detail about how these numbers are actually made up in the paper itself, but I've sort of had to jump through that. But that's right. That's sort of what's happening in those stress tests.
They would have 800 assets, a defaulting employer, and the 155 and the 175 on a 99.5 percentile would fall to, say, 100. They'd be 100 short. So the members of that pension fund would be not protected by that solvency capital requirement in a 99.5% scenario.
But this is saying that the fund isn't adequately funded today. So today, it doesn't have... So that 175 isn't in the fund today. Yeah? So... What this is saying is that the fund needs total assets of 1,175, needs 1,000 plus 175, and it's got 955. So this analysis is saying the fund has to go and get another, whatever that is, of additional assets in order to be funded to that VAR 99.5% level.
Are there any more questions? Yes.
Sorry, Paul Kelly. You, in your paper, you say that you haven't dealt with longevity and inflation in the SCR calculation, but you note that it is likely to be. a significant impact. Do you have any rough idea, given that those are in the QIS?
Sorry, it's a very good question. I haven't done any explicit quantitative numbers on that. So I would generally speculate that the inflation one would be sort of a similar level to the nominal weight. I'd have to speculate, but basically what this example we're seeing, you know, the solvency level of 12 to 18%, and I think given those material risks aren't there, we could, you know, expect it to be another margin on top of that, in terms of what we'd realistically expect once you include all of those risks. Albeit this is a very stylized example, and you know, there'll be lots of interesting real life features to incorporate into these sorts of calculations.
Okay, thank you.
Question over here.
Graham Clay. Do you consider the relative strength of the sponsor covenant and the covenant on a bond issued by the sponsor? And if so, how? And secondly, on a purely domestic point, before the second presentation, could the panel come out so that we don't get heads in the way of the bottom third of each slide?
On your first question, I've made the simplifying assumption here that essentially the covenants, if you like, are sort of compatible, or comparable in the sense that I've assumed a loss given default for the pension fund, for the sponsor covenant, which is similar to that on an unsecured, you know, corporate bond. So again, where scheme specifics dictate that there's clearly a different type of hierarchy there, then there'd be nothing stopping you making those different assumptions here. But in this context, that's what we've done.
Yep. Sorry, there's a question over there.
On that specific point of default probabilities, just to check my understanding, so are you using there the actual credit spread on the corporate bond of the sponsor and assuming that all of that premium is in respect of default probability? Or are you kind of using the credit rating, which you subsequently referred to, in kind of using a transition matrix based on the credit spread? Or is it a combination of both?
So in the valuation, we're using risk-neutral probabilities that are derived from credit spreads. Those credit spreads could be for a liquid sponsor, if you like, a FTSE 100 company. Those spreads could be directly observed from the sponsor's corporate bonds. For smaller businesses, we could simply allocate a rating to them and then look at what a ratings curve looks like and derive risk-neutral default probabilities from there. But in the valuation, we're not using... we are using a ratings-based approach, but it's calibrated to those risk-neutral credit spreads. So we're not using any sort of real-world transition matrix in that valuation, because it's a risk-neutral valuation, essentially. So the only place where we do use a sort of real-world transition matrix is in the solvency piece, where we're identifying the size of the credit downgrade stress.
Aidan Omani from Aon Hewitt. I spent a lot of time in the credit rating business, but I know a lot of the data is actually calibrated off US ratings, which has obviously the greatest universe of data. The European data, and especially the UK data, is very limited. So is there a danger of contagion that essentially if we do calibrate to ratings, we're getting a US-style probabilities of default and transitions imposed on a UK system?
Yeah, no, it's an interesting question. I mean, in the valuation work here, we're trying to directly use the UK, the relevant bond prices. So it's not reliant on ratings to that extent, in that, you know, if we're doing this for you know, Marks and Spencers, we look at what the Marks and Spencers credit spreads are, and that is the data that we use. So in that sense, it's not directly, you know, a function of how the rating agencies have treated, you know, UK sponsors and how it differs from US and what the historical data is.
Yeah, I think that's a good answer. But I would point out as well that a lot of the sponsors, say even M&S, Marks and Spencer, most of the time it's not the PLC that is the sponsor of the IORP or whatever. So you do have a kind of a subsidiary issue there as well.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's not a point I've addressed in this paper yet.
One final question for this moment.
Could you just
microphone, please.
Could you just clarify one point? You're looking at credit spreads. Are you using the naked spread, or are you decomposing the spread into liquidity default and default volatility terms? Which is it that you're doing?
So for the market consistent valuation, it's the former. It's a naked spread because it's intended to be a market consistent valuation. So all we care about is what the market price of that debt is. That's the approach.
Then you're pricing all sorts of wrong things in there.
Well, we're not taking a view on whether the market price is right or wrong. We're just taking a view on what's consistent. Yeah, but I think it depends on the question you're trying to answer. To create a value which is intended to be consistent with that market value, we don't have to make that decomposition.
Yeah, but that's got nothing to do with default. I mean, it's got a very small amount to do with default.
Yep, yep.
You're calibrating this thing to something which has two other terms,
yep,
which are more important than the default term.
Yep,
net, you are exaggerating the likelihood of default massively.
But I'm not trying to estimate the probability of default. I'm trying to estimate the market-based cost of bearing exposure to default.
The problem is that the market-based measure is actually exposure to rather a lot more than just default.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you are not being market consistent in estimating market default. Okay?
Yeah, okay, yeah, something to discuss about.
Well, nice discussion. Difficult matter. Shall we relieve you? And
thank you.
But there is much more time for further discussion. Then I would like to invite Adam Sutton, Richard Setchim, and Hesh Pepperdy from PwC to present their paper. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much indeed. Hello, I'm Richard Setchim. I lead the PwC team here. A PwC partner for the last 25 years, a chartered accountant, and an insolvency practitioner. In this building, I could perhaps call myself a company doctor. A few words on me before I introduce my colleagues. I was a trustee of the PwC staff scheme for 10 years, and I enjoyed the interaction with members of your profession so much that my client work is now full-time pensions advisory, specifically helping trustees understand their sponsor's covenant. And PwC has a team of 50 people nationally who do that over a broad range of market sectors. My own client work includes financial institutions, a couple of clearing banks, and a life insurer. So the world of financial regulation and Solvency II stress testing is a familiar one to me. Now, I am joined on the platform by Adam Sutton and also Hesh Pepperdy, and they will introduce themselves more fully before they speak. I have another specialist valuations colleague in the front row, Charles Sword, who will be sitting on the platform in Edinburgh, and Charles may join us for questions. Now, my task is to set our work in context, and it was a very happy day back in October 2011 when the AOPA consultation hit my desk, and it hit it hard. It was 512 pages long. Now, it was of particular interest to me as a covenant assessor because of the holistic balance sheet. And I thought before we start, the context that you need to have is what the holistic balance sheet is about and what it's trying to achieve. Now, this is how it's described, and I won't read what you can see on the screen. Key points, quantifying the obligations and the resources available. We've reproduced a schematic of the holistic balance sheet in our paper. You'll find it on page 68, but I'm not going to put it up on the screen because it really is a very busy slide. But what I can say as an accountant in the room is that it's not like any balance sheet you've seen before, Jim. Now, IORPA describes it as follows: an assessment tool rather than the usual balance sheet based on generally agreed accounting principles. There is no set of books that you'll be able, no one set of books that you're going to be able to tick it to. But why it's interesting is for this reason, that it includes all the economic exposures to which the IORP is exposed, whether they would be on a conventional balance sheet or not. The driving principles, and these really are important to understand what it's all about. The balance sheet views security from the perspective of the member, rather than the financing vehicle. And consequently, the asset side should capture all the resources that can be used to meet or fulfill, in their words, the pension promise. Now, these resources, of course, include the sponsor support. And if the balance sheet is ever to balance, the method for valuing the sponsor support has to allow sufficient cover for the obligations, including those risk reserves on the obligation side. That is a really big point. And in IORPA's own words, a major difference from the Solvency II directive. Now, despite this major difference from Solvency II, in terms of valuing those resources, IORPA noted as follows: that they want the values to be on market, consistent, sound economic principles, i.e. made according to fair value. Now, back in October, I wondered how on earth that was going to be achieved. And when the quiz specification was produced, the draft one, we worked on holistic balance sheets for 20 clients. And it became quickly apparent that the methodology derived a value for sponsor covenant which didn't reflect the commercial reality that we see every day. And that's what led me to engage with specialist colleagues who spend their working lives valuing businesses. And it's these practitioner insights that we bring in our paper as our contribution to the debate. And as some will know, the debate remains live because IORPA has acknowledged that this area of the advice to the Commission needs more work, and a further working party has been set up to make further recommendations. Now, having outlined the context of our challenge, what we're now going to do is as follows. We're going to demonstrate how the quiz values sponsor support, and Hash, the actuary, is going to do that. And he's going to do it by looking closely at the example in our paper. We're assuming that not all of you will have done your homework before coming this evening. And we are then going to step into the world of business valuations. Adam is going to do that for us, having introduced methods which hopefully will be familiar to many. He's going to look at the same example that Hash first looked at through a valuer's lens. And he's then going to go on to describe the methodology that we've put forward, which we believe is not only flexible, but flexible enough to allow for sponsor-specific valuations on consistent principles well understood in the market, and one which views those assets from the perspective of the member while ticking those good boxes of transparency, consistency, and verifiability. So turning first to Hash Pippity.
Thank you, Richard. So my name's Hash Pippity. I'm an actuary in PwC's pensions practice. And I feel intimately acquainted with the IORPs specifications, having run holistic balance sheets or been involved in the 20 or so examples that we've looked at. And what I'm going to do over the next few minutes is give an overview of the formulas, so the methodology in the technical specification in the for the quiz, and bring that to life with the example that's in our paper in section 4 to show what the numbers look like and share some observations with you. Okay. So starting with a couple of formulas that I'm sure you're all familiar with. It was always going to be a challenge to come up with a mathematical formula that values 6,000 or so sponsors, but IORPs introduce two concepts. So there's maximum sponsor support and market sponsor support. And you'll be relieved to know, I'm not actually going to go through the details of the formulas, but in principle, the market value is based on the deficit in the scheme today. So if you look at the technical provisions less the financial assets, technical provisions measured on a risk-free measure, and project that into the future over the next 15 or 20 years or so, and allow for the probability of the employer defaulting on those contributions, introducing an element of credit risk. And then there's a terminal value, so if the employer does default, how much would of that deficit would be recovered. So that's focused purely on the position, the funding position of the pension scheme and how it varies over time, and how much do you need to plug that deficit. The focus of our research is the maximum value, which actually looks at, okay, what are the wider resources of the business available backing this particular pension scheme? Not just looking at the funding position, but thinking in terms of the holistic balance sheet where you're considering the uncertainty around the solvency capital requirement. What are the wider resources of the business that are available? And that's conceptually made up of two components, the future wealth and the current wealth. So how does IORPs define those terms? Well, starting on the right-hand side, current wealth is based on the sponsor's balance sheet. So you take 50% of the shareholder funds in the sponsor's balance sheet and add on the pension liability, so the liability that's recorded, or the deficit, if you like, under IAS 19, for example. And then looking forward, in terms of future wealth, we've got two components. We've got the recovery plan contributions. So under the schedule of contributions at the moment, what's the sponsor actually committed to in terms of the recovery plan? Put a present value on those. And on top of those, the key driver is projected future cash flows or future earnings. So taking 33% of the projected cash flows of the business projected over the average duration of the scheme. So just want to share perhaps three key observations on this formula. So firstly, there's potentially an element of double counting. So when doing a discounted cash flow valuation for business valuation purposes, typically, you would only consider the future earnings generated by the assets of the business. So by adding back the assets that are used, that are actually generating those earnings, potentially there's an element of double counting there. The second observation is, and this is typical of the 20 or so examples that we've looked at, looking at future earnings or future cash flows, the term cash flow isn't actually defined. So if you pick up a set of company accounts, there's lots of different lines giving different values for cash flows. Which one do you take? So even if you have, so depending on, you could take operating cash flows, financing, and so on, and depending on which ones you use, clearly the maximum sponsor support value is going to be very sensitive to those. The third observation is around the discount rate. So in a business valuation, does it really make sense to use the same discount rate that you'd use to discount the pension liabilities? Probably not. So bringing this to life with the example in our paper in section four, the situation is you have a single company sponsoring a scheme with assets of $2.5 billion and technical provisions of $4 billion. So immediately you've got a deficit, if you like, of $1.5 billion to try and cover with sponsor support. And looking at applying the formula, the IORPs methodology, the current wealth of the sponsor is $400 million from the shareholder funds, and another $400 million you add back for the pension liability on the balance sheet, so that's $800 million. And in terms of future earnings, the value of the recovery plan contributions are just under $600 million or so. And the key driver of value for this particular example is a third of future projected cash flows. So we've interpreted cash flows as equity cash flows, given the way the formula is constructed, and that only gives you around £300 million. Putting that all together, we get a maximum sponsor support value of around £1.7 billion. So if you remember, you had £1.5 billion in terms of deficit, and that was before you even considered the solvency capital requirement to go on top. So to give this some context, for illustration, what does the holistic balance sheet look like for this particular example? So I'm not going to go through each of the components here, but you can clearly see that having a maximum sponsor support value of only £1.7 billion actually leaves me with a £1 billion gap, if you like, in the holistic balance sheet, and a pretty unhappy client. So on that note, I'm going to pass over to my colleague Adam, who's going to talk about how to plug the gap.
Thank you, Hash. So Hash has left me as an accountant with a balance sheet that doesn't balance, which is a quite horrifying concept for an accountant. My background is I've been a business valuer now for around 12 years. I've valued over 500 companies in that time. For a variety of purposes, disputes, acquisitions and disposals, financial reporting. And most recently, I've been working a lot with the trustees of the Nortel pension scheme, doing a lot of valuation work there. So when Richard first came and dumped the 500 pages of the report on my desk, it was a pretty exciting day, actually, because I could apply my business valuer's mindset to what I thought of as essentially a question about business value. So before I explain how we've thought about a methodology for addressing this question, what I wanted to do was just take your minds back to what Hash assures me was some study that you would have done in the dim and distant days of your training. So the basics of some of these business valuation techniques. So on the slide here, I've got essentially three approaches. The income approach, or discounted cash flow. The market approach, which is typically measured using either listed companies or transactions as a guide. And then on the far right, cost approaches. Now, the most commonly used valuation techniques in business valuation are the first two, DCF and market approach. I have put cost approach there because sometimes it is a relevant approach to use in a distress scenario where you might be looking at liquidation valuation. Taking the income approach first, there are two key inputs here. One is your cash flow forecasts or business plan for the sponsor, and the other is the discount rate. Now, there are potentially quite a significant number of variables and considerations that need to go into those cash flows. So I've listed just a few there: macroeconomic, market and industry positioning, the specific market positioning and competitive positioning of the sponsor. Those are just some of the things that I, as a business valuer, would consider when I'm assessing a set of cash flows. The other element, which you're obviously all very familiar with, is a discount rate. So we would typically use a capital asset pricing model to come up with a weighted average cost of capital for the business or the sponsor. And that gives me my DCF valuation, the discounting of the future cash flows of the sponsor. Turning to the market approach, I've got two options. I can try to find listed companies which are similar to my sponsor, or I can go and try and find some transactions, so where people have bought and sold businesses, to give me a guide as to what values have been paid for businesses which are similar to my sponsor. Now, in terms of the actual calculations, it's pretty simple applying a market approach. The tricky bit is in, first of all, finding the right comparables and the analysis that goes behind assessing their comparability to your sponsor. So should you be adjusting, for example, the multiples that are derived from those comparisons when you get to your valuation of the sponsor? So Hash left us with a problem, a balance sheet that doesn't balance. I'm going to just take you through some simple numbers, a market approach and the DCF or income approach, to explain how I viewed this valuation question. So starting on the left, the market approach, I managed to find some transactions and some listed companies. I've looked at business value as a measure over EBITDA, which is earnings before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization, which is a very commonly used measure of earnings to calculate a multiple. And on the transaction side, I got a number of 8 to 9 times EBITDA for my comparable transactions. On the listed companies, they were showing 7 to 8 times EBITDA, which resulted in the valuation ranges for the business that you can see underneath. So an overall range of 3.7 to 4.8 billion in this case. Now, I apply my judgment as a valuer. I could choose one end or other of that range. I could plump for something in the middle. I could decide that I'm more happy with one approach and the quality of the data and analysis that's coming from transactions versus listed companies, or vice versa. In this simple example, I've just taken a number that's broadly in the middle. So 4.2 billion is my business valuation conclusion. I've taken off the net debt, which doesn't include the pension liability, and that's given me a value of sponsor support of 4 billion. I've conducted a similar analysis using my DCF approach on the right-hand side. So I get down to a measure of free cash flows, which are the cash flows to all of the providers of capital to the business. So I haven't subtracted any debt-related cash flows at that stage. I've got a forecast period there of about 3 years, and then I've applied a terminal value. And I've made an assumption about future long-term growth for this business. I've present valued those cash flows using the weighted average cost of capital that I've calculated for this business, and that's given me a business valuation conclusion of 4.5 billion. I take off the same net debt number, and that results in a value of sponsor support of 4.3. So my valuation conclusion is a range, because valuers typically give you ranges of 4 to 4.3 billion, which you'll note is significantly higher than Hash's answer of 1.7 billion. And interestingly, the market cap of this particular business was around the 4 billion mark. So a much higher answer. And that's illustrated in the comparison to Hash's picture of the holistic balance sheet on the left-hand side compared to the one on the right, which shows the value of sponsor support in that case is easily sufficient to fill the gap. So that brings me on to the approach that we feel is a sensible and reasonable approach to apply. And essentially, this is a staged approach. And the reason we thought it should be a staged or phased approach is because we realise that there are probably a lot of companies out there, a lot of sponsors, who can fairly easily support their pension schemes. And therefore, we wanted to give them the option of doing something relatively high level, a little bit quick and dirty, in order to tick the box, while recognising that there are companies who are similarly likely to be very close to the line or even below the line in terms of filling that gap and therefore need a much more robust and rigorous approach to valuation. So stage one is to value the sponsor support using market multiples. So that will give me a value of sponsor support, which I then say, is that a certain multiple of the holistic balance sheet deficit? And I've put 2x, and I've deliberately put it in square brackets there, because I think this is clearly a point for discussion. You know, what is sufficient? What is a level above which you perhaps wouldn't need to do any more work, that you'd be satisfied? And clearly that would depend on the type of industry, the volatility of the earnings of companies within that industry, and obviously the particular sponsor as well. So if the answer to that question is yes, stop, sponsor support is clearly sufficient. If the answer is no, then we go on to stage two, which is a more rigorous application of the valuation methods that I've just described. So we would look at both a refinement of the market multiples approach and a DCF analysis for that business. And using that analysis, we would apply our judgment to reach what we consider to be a reasonable maximum value of sponsor support. And if the business is in distress, you might have seen from our paper, we included a short piece on something that we described as the demise curve, the corporate demise curve, which was really just an illustration of how companies at different points on that curve may be relevant to apply different types of valuation methodologies to them. So if you are a highly distressed business, then the maximum value of your sponsor support may be related to what you can realise for those assets in an insolvency. So just to summarise our approach and our method, it's grounded in business valuation theory, so it'll be recognisable to anyone who's done a valuation in an accounting or deals context. So, for example, in the accounting world, you have annual impairment tests, so companies are required to essentially carry out a business valuation to test the carrying value of the assets on their balance sheet. And the approaches that we're talking about here are no different to that. Our approach, we believe, allows more flexibility and the greater application of judgment, which is more suited to the variety that you see in the UK pensions landscape. It's proportionate, meaning that for some businesses, the approach will be relatively quick and simple to apply, while for others, there will need to be a robust process to determine whether or not headroom exists, and if so, how much. And lastly, it's consistent with approaches that we currently see in the market in terms of assessing the covenant, the strength of the covenant of the sponsor. Thank you very much.
Time for questions. There's already one question over there. Technical question still, so not the full discussion yet.
JD. On slide 4 of Hash's presentation, we had assets of 2.5 and liabilities of 4 billion, leaving 1.5 billion deficit. Tell me, please, how do you get to 400 million deficit on the balance sheet under something like IAS 19? I know that the numbers might be massaged a bit, but not that much, surely.
Those were the answers taken from the accounts. So it's not the liability, it's the net deficit.
Yeah, the net deficit is 1.5, not 400. 4 minus 2.5 is 1.5, not 0.4.
accounting basis significantly weaker than using a negative net discount rate.
So it's being massaged, right?
There's a question up there.
Hi. A question on the discounted cash flow. I noticed the terminal value is a massive component of the present value. What kind of assumptions do you use to come up with the terminal value? So that's question one. Question two is, around the approaches taken to come up with a value for the business, if you're using a discounted cash flow and a multiples approach, shouldn't you be able to reconcile the two approaches, i.e., shouldn't you be able to back out market implied assumptions from using multiples by essentially using the same model for discounted cash flow?
So to answer your first question, we would either use a multiple to calculate the terminal value, or more commonly a Gordon growth model. So look at what we consider to be a reasonable terminal year cash flow, and that might involve projecting out the business plan for the sponsor further than the example I've shown there, and then considering what's an applicable long-term growth rate might be, taking into account that industry and the macroeconomic context in which that business is operating. And you're right, you should be able to, your approaches should market and DCF be consistent. They're not, you don't always find in valuation consistency between the two approaches. There are some reasons and circumstances in which they won't be consistent, and I think that's where the application of judgment comes in.
Any other technical questions? Two. Well, the closest to me first.
Hi, it's Tim Keogh, and I should say I work for the Painters Regulator, but this is a personal question for my education, having not been particularly close to this project. Seems like one reason, when you're trying to reconcile the 1.7 billion number, which is clearly, you know, a strange AOPA number, and your 4 billion kind of mark to market, isn't one of the things in that gap that you would surely want to take a haircut to the current market implied value of the sponsor? Or increase your solvency capital to allow for the fact there is uncertainty in that number? And I guess I just wondered if you looked at either of those things.
I mean, I think good valuation practice would involve looking at sensitivities to your numbers, and they could be upward or downward sensitivities. The valuation that we've calculated as an expected value, rather than a prudent value, although it does, there are elements of prudence in it, in the sense that the only debt added back is, or taken off is the added back is the pension debt. So this scheme would rank equally with some other creditors within the business, and arguably, therefore, the number might be a little bit bigger.
I mean, I suppose maybe this is almost a question for Hash, but what's in my mind is the assets the pension scheme has, you allow for the uncertainty around that on the liability side of the balance sheet in the thing called SCR. So would it be consistent to have some sort of equivalent allowance for uncertainty on the in the covenant? Now, whether you actually have a lower covenant number or a higher SCR doesn't seem to matter, I guess, but do you want to do one or the other?
Everyone's looking at each other.
We could, one of you's got to do something.
Tim, I'll give you the non-technical answer. I mean, we thought the liability side was really stacked quite high enough, because not only have you got the deficit, the 1.5 is on a risk-free rate. So, you know, although it's called technical provisions, it looks awfully like the buyout level of funding in the current world, but you add on these, I mean, what I in a non-technical way call these Rumsfeld layers for the unknown unknowns, and then the challenge is what are the assets available to cover that? As I say, our starting point was that the method which is proposed currently doesn't seem to make enough allowance for the cover for all these levels. We've in our methodology, which is kind of, I described it as a contribution to the debate rather than as a 512 pages of settled methodology. And I think that we've alluded to this in, is it two times or is it three times? There's a bit of judgment there. But I think the obligation side of this balance sheet is a very comprehensive piece of work, which I didn't want to add to. It's the asset side that we're focusing on.
Just to add to Richard's comments, I mean, in the examples I've looked at, before you start even thinking about the sponsor support value, you've got a solvency capital requirement of some 20 to 30% of the liabilities, depending on what proportion of your assets in equities. So you're already thinking about a considerable increase above the risk-free rate of the liabilities.
I should perhaps say that in case we've given the impression that this was an exercise to make the asset side as high as possible, there were examples in the 20 that we looked at where applying the method produced a higher value for sponsor covenant than we would regard as a normal valuation. So this isn't just about chucking in as much as possible to keep clients happy. This is really trying to propose methodology that is appropriate to the circumstances.
There was another question over there. And I see a question there and there, okay.
Thank you. It's in relation to, is it two times or three times is the appropriate number on the maximum sponsor or maximum value of sponsor support? I think two times intuitively feels very low when you consider all the variables in there and the fact that I think no dividends have been coming out of that business, which is, I think, slightly unrealistic. So, it could be two, it could be three, it could be four. The danger, of course, is that when you start making assumptions, we can get any number we want if we just double it or half it. So it's quite an imprecise science, and, I think we must not be... hoodwinked into believing we're giving absolute or precise values here. I think this is a very kind of theoretical approach.
Valuation does involve judgment, and there are ranges, but there are reasonable ranges, and robust analysis will get you to as narrow a reasonable range as you can. But I think those multiples are... very industry dependent, and it'll be interesting over time to see if you could build up a set of statistics which allow you to more accurately assess or based on the data that you've collected what is a reasonable number for that particular sector or type of business.
The approach, I think, is do a quick calculation and see is it two times at least coverage, and then if it is, kind of put it to one side. As I say, I think that maybe if you had asked people, polled people in advance, it may be three times maybe would be the view. So I don't know if you can calibrate that in any way. So it's
we had actually had three times in the number of drafts of the paper, didn't we? And then, in the last few iterations, we were trying to get rid of the inconsistencies. We had two in some places and three in another, and we ended up with two. So, but I take your point.
A question over there.
Catherine Hildebrand, question for Adam. Can you comment on the availability and objectivity of the projected cash flows and also the multiples? Because these are both concepts I'm not that familiar with.
In terms of multiples, there are a number of databases that are readily accessible to find transactions which have occurred. And for a listed company, similarly, there are a lot of information sources that will give you that data. So that's not hard to come by. And on the discounted cash flow, I think that's a very good question. What sort of access to information would people have to be able to do this calculation? I think our view is that sponsors should, if this becomes what they need to do, then they should be able to provide, either do the calculations or provide whoever's doing the calculations with a business plan as a basis for valuation.
But that sort of information isn't routinely available to trustees right now?
It is available to some trustees. Would that be a fairer way of putting it? It depends, I guess. It's something that may need to change if this becomes law.
And there was higher up. Yes, a gentleman.
Sorry, can I just add just one more point? I think if you're in a situation where you are close to the edge, then I think there's every incentive for the sponsor to share that sort of information with the trustee and make sure an appropriate answer is reached.
And just as a more general point, because although we are looking at the components of the balance sheet, my hope is that this approach, I mean, if we are able to agree on how a holistic balance sheet should be reached at, should serve to improve the joint approach to these issues between sponsor and trustees. And I spend quite a lot of my time playing a game of tennis and kind of hitting the funding ball as far as possible over the net, and it comes back as hard as possible, and that's just not the right way to do it. So I'm less concerned about the availability of information, because I think it will be in sponsors' interest to reach the right numbers.
You're favouring an approach that involves much more judgment than the sort of approach that was proposed, which is much more sort of parameterised and formulaic, and I think that's right. But in sort of bringing your practitioner's experience, how do you think it will work where, you know, with evaluation, you've got a lot of uncertainty, you give ranges for these sorts of things, and also sort of any valuation of a business is potentially subject to some sort of bias as well, where you've got to agree a covenant valuation between trustees, sponsors, and potentially the regulator too. How do you see that working in practice?
I think a robust debate probably is the answer. I think where you could extend the methodologies would be to perhaps try and give some idea of what are the probabilities of various ranges in the valuation, just so that people can see what the extent of the range, probability of the range might be. And that, I think, would help to illustrate how variable the number is.
And the point I would add, and it was in my introduction, is the perspective is intended to be that of the member. And as a member, I'm interested in my scheme and my sponsor. And I think the conversation between my sponsor and my trustees will go rather more smoothly if the valuation methodology at least enables there to be sufficient cover for the obligations, rather than starting off with a built-in gap. But you almost, it's a political question almost, you have to choose your axis. Comparability is something that IAS 19 tries to achieve, so that you can read across financial statements, and that isn't scheme specific because you won't be able to read across financial statements, and the number produced was described in the audience as a fudge. Well, it's a necessary fudge in order to achieve that comparability. And what we're looking at is a method that people start off by saying it's very difficult to value sponsor covenant, sponsor by sponsor. Yes, it is difficult, but it can be done. And at the moment, we do that, but in a qualitative way. This is a way of doing it on a sponsor-specific basis and produce a number at the end of it. But people are going to have to kind of, you know, take their choices on the starting points, and that's why I started by, what's it for? And who are you doing this for?
Given the, well, one last question, and then given the time, I would like to go to the full discussion. But one final question over there. Higher up.
A question for Adam, which I hope is not too unfair. How realistically do you think the market reflects the very different levels of threat or liability that the pension represents from one company to another?
I think my observation is that sometimes the market doesn't seem to reflect in some companies the full extent of the issue. Certainly I've seen in less heavily traded businesses a significant sort of difference between what I would regard as being an equity value versus what the business seems to be trading at given its pension situation.
Thank you. And please join me in thanking the PwC delegation. Then the discussion is now open to you all, a full discussion, and I'm really looking forward to an interesting and stimulating debate. And I would like you not to be shy. I know that this event is recorded, but there is still a possibility to edit what you have said. So, it won't necessarily be published. And I like a very open and frank debate. But please say your name clearly in the microphone. That makes it easier for the editing, if necessary, afterwards. Yes, is there anyone who would like to start? Please, can, yeah, one over there, a second one, third, okay, three starters. And there is dinner afterwards. Oh, three starters. My English is not that good, but I would like to start over here.
I seem to have got the microphone first, so I start. Simon Wills from Gazelle, and I wanted to introduce you to some, or into the discussion, some work that we've been doing, which has to do with valuing sponsor covenant risk rather than the sponsor covenant support. I think both papers demonstrated that it isn't easy to develop a practical quantitative approach to valuing the sponsor covenant itself, which is required by the sort of IORPs insurance-based approach. And it's also rather unclear what to do with the results when the holistic balance sheet doesn't balance and what happens, really. Sometime before the IORPs proposals came into focus, I guess we rather independently set about developing a quantitative methodology for valuing covenant risk itself. And we felt that the current UK pension regulatory framework was in tune more with characterising pension deficits as debts, really, and with a debt-like obligation from an employer to the pension scheme, where it's not certain whether the employer can pay the contributions required to fund the scheme benefit. So not an insurance-based approach, but more of a debt-based approach. And quantification of default risk as a monetary value is a cornerstone of banking regulation and determining bank capital requirements, and that's where we started, and we set about trying to adapt that to pension obligations, which are rather different from loans, being rather longer term, having no fixed term structure, and being a rather open-ended obligation, allowing affordability constraints and things like that to play out. And we've done that by integrating sort of the actuarial scheme funding model with a stochastic model of employer financial resources alongside the default risk quantification used in debt markets. And it works rather neatly. And one byproduct is of integrating the actuarial model is you get a quantitative linkage between the covenant risk, the liability risk, and the investment risk, which is what quite a lot of people have been looking for. And I suppose
we aren't producing a paper today, but a description of the methodologies on our website, the Gazelle website, under the heading Gazelle MT or Mousetrap, which we call the model. So please have a look. I think being able to quantify covenant risk solves quite a few problems. You can use it you can use the value of covenant risk to adjust the technical provisions discount rate in scheme valuations, which is quite helpful. It's obviously good for transactions because it gives a very precise before and after covenant risk answer and comparison. And I think in conjunction with asset liability modelling, it could give funding targets which reflect both uncertain contributions and uncertain investment performance acting in tandem. And it should give the PPF a very accurate idea of its financial exposure to schemes. So I suppose the question, given it sort of gives the current existing regulatory approach we have in the UK some quantitative teeth, which perhaps it lacks at the moment. And we're left wondering whether the insurance approach to quantification will really be necessary if the current approach had quantitative teeth. And if the market can really access quantified covenant risk values for defined benefit schemes and use those to manage pension risks, do we need to value as a balance sheet item sponsor support? That's my contribution to the discussion.
I don't know what the normal procedure is here, but are we going to the next person who raised the hand, or
I think
now commenting on this?
I think probably it's sort of one at a time and just see if any of the panel have good anything to say to it.
Is there anybody who would like to react?
I'm always happy to get a ball rolling, so I'll stop ball rolling. Our starting point was a response to the IORP consultation. So we are faced with the insurance-based approach to liabilities, and so we turned our mind, exactly as I've said, to what could a methodology be that is well understood in the market, well understood not just in financial services but across market sectors for deriving values that would achieve AOPA's objective of showing all the assets that the pensions obligation, if you like, can rely on. So that is our starting point. Whether in a parallel world or in another world, or if the IORP didn't come to pass, whether there are lessons that could be learned either from here or indeed the mousetrap, it is a question beyond the remit. But my challenge to our valuers was exactly to using methods that aren't, if you like, too new, because they have to be understood and capable of verification, challenge, and all the rest of the things. Is there a way of achieving what AOPA is setting out to do? There were plenty of commentators who were kind of challenging whether AOPA should be there at all, but that isn't where I was going.
And one of the remarks you made, I think it was one of the first remarks, what to do if there is no balance? And I think that is a very interesting question. First of all, it is, of course, how do we value everything, the liabilities, all the add-ons to the liabilities, the sponsor of the SCR, the solvency capital requirement. And if it doesn't, and then on the other hand, the assets and sponsor covenant, if it doesn't balance, I think, but I'm just talking from my perspective, which is a Dutch perspective, I would say, well, let's sit on the table with all the stakeholders and discuss what the situation is. And that is still, for me, I think that this could be a call for real discussion on what is it? What is the pension promise in the first place, which is, I would say, a social contract between employer and employees. And so these two parties can decide what it is and what it is not. And perhaps we are taking things a bit too much for granted because we are not really discussing things. At least that is what I'm saying, again, from a Dutch perspective. And I think over the last couple of years, we have tried to be clearer in what the pension promise really is. Well, to make it more explicit, if a pension promise is like an insurance product, if it is a fully guaranteed promise, you will always get your pension no matter what happens, then I think it is very difficult to argue that a different method from insurance valuation should be applied. But well, interesting. But I think that in most cases, pensions, given the social contract element, are not a full guarantee. But that is difficult to discuss because people, the members, normally experience it as a full guarantee and want to keep experience it as a full guarantee, and other people don't want to, well, break the dream or to make it different. But a full guarantee is, in my view, impossible. It is just not possible to have so much money in the end. If it would really be a full guarantee, you need an infinite amount of money. That is, I think, what theory says. That is not possible, so we already allow for some uncertainty, also in the insurance side, 99.5% certainty. But perhaps for pensions, it's lower. And why not discuss that more clearly? And why shouldn't we invite social partners to become more clear on what is the pension contract? And of course, if we have done so, all the mathematical elements that are behind, or the judgment of valuation, which I like, to be honest, should follow from that. But perhaps we should set a step back first and look what is the real promise? Well, just for discussion. Over there.
Hi, Francis Fernandez, Lincoln International. Just to echo that point, actually, I'd like to thank the authors for their contributions to this important topic. But actually, at the beginning and all through the discussions, people were referring back to what is the view from the person, from the pension member, about this. And actually, just thinking about the building in which we're in at the moment and the analogy you were drawing, we can get overcomplicating it. It's a bit like asking, going to see your doctor once every year, doing a series of complicated tests, and them just saying, actually, you should be dead every year. You should be dead without any remedy in here. And it's quite good that in the paper, I think in the middle of page 69, there is a reference to what happens if you fail the holistic balance sheet test. And the key thing is, what is this all about? What happens if you fail? What do you do about it? At the moment, it's very unclear as to what it is, so who cares how it's calculated? So, from my point of view, I just think we need to take a step back and think, actually, some of the things that you've highlighted in here raise lots of questions. I did a lot of work in M&A, in banks, valuing businesses for transactions, where actually it highlighted the problems of multiple approaches, and I think some of the questions and points are well made about terminal values and multiples. At the same time, if you overcomplicate stochastic models, we're drawing market data around using corporate bond spreads, when actually that's not the entity sponsoring the scheme. Again, you introduce just a lot of questions, which are very valuable for everyone in the room to be familiar with. But at the heart of it, and I'd be quite interested, we've got a lot of august guests down here. What happens if you fail? What's the remedy? It matters to the member, so tell us what you're going to do if you fail the HBS.
Would it be possible to discuss that up front, what would happen if the balance sheet wouldn't balance? That is the debate in the Netherlands at the moment, to make the pension contract more transparent and discuss up front with the partners, the social partners, what will happen if. And of course, in the end, there will always be a situation that you haven't been able to think of beforehand, but at least to trying to describe a lot of possible scenarios that can occur, and the actions that you can do or are not willing to do, because pensions is part of a total remuneration package, and you can ask a lot of additional capital for pensions, but well, that should come from somewhere. So lower salaries, or people need to be fired, or it is also balancing with other elements. So we can get the pensions right, but then we have a problem elsewhere, I think, and that is also something that we need to balance, and that is makes the discussion even more difficult, of course, because. Well, pensions only is already very difficult given, well, the whole debate that we are already having.
Kevin Wasbroom, not from Aon Hewitt, because they dissociate themselves from me straight away. something about consistency, market consistency. I'm sitting here and I'm thinking we've got a valuation method on one side of the balance sheet to come up with a very big number to face off to a number on the other side of the balance sheet. And the methods are just wholly inconsistent. So on the liability side, we've got a risk-free rate. As far as I'm aware, nobody, when they're valuing businesses, uses risk-free rates. So why are we bothering with trying to get consistency here? Or perhaps what we ought to be doing is using judgment to put a value on the liability side. Well, you can see where this one's going, boys. Join me going back to the 1970s. We can get there, actual values, rather than mark-to-market values. The other thing that struck me was Hash and Adam seemed slightly surprised that they came up with different values, but Hash is fighting with one hand tied behind his back because his method takes off half the shareholder's value and a third of the income. I think if Adam did that, he'd probably come up with the same number, wouldn't he?
No reaction from the panel?
You're in terms of the numbers, yes, that in the IOPA approach does have significant prudence built into it, and it's taking 33% of the cash flows, which my approach doesn't. So, yes. I guess I feigned surprise, but I think it was important just to illustrate the magnitude of the difference.
There's another important difference. You normalise the cash flows rather than just taking the actual ones. I mean, the example here, I mean, Hash, you might like to...
Yeah, so the example that we look at in our paper, the reason the company is actually penalised is actually it had negative cash flows in two of the last 3 years, which it actually used to pay down debt in the business. So a covenant-enhancing measure, the pension scheme's perspective, actually destroyed value in this particular calculation. So there's additional elements of judgment involved.
Yeah, which did surprise Adam.
Well, I must say I like the idea of judgment in the valuation of the liabilities. But it should be based on the contract. Well, and I'm going back to what I said earlier, the contract between social partners. I was a while ago referring to the 99.5% certainty, and perhaps that is one of the elements that we can change and make lower, or probably not higher, lower. Another way of doing it, and that could also be market consistent, is saying, well, we accept that the pension promise is not fully guaranteed, so a risk-free rate is not the appropriate discount rate, because that belongs to a fully guaranteed liability. If it is not fully guaranteed, well, tell us, social partners, what the discount rate should be. How uncertain is your pension promise? How uncertain do you want to have it? And that could then be the risk-free rate plus a risk premium, like is the case on the asset side. If assets are uncertain, it is also in the basis a risk-free rate from theory plus a risk premium. So perhaps we can ask social partners to tell us what the risk premium of the pension promise should be. And that would make it easier, but because then we actuaries can put that into our calculators and define and come up with the valuation of the liabilities. But that could be much lower than on a risk-free rate. And not because we want to have it lower, no, because it reflects the risk appetite of the social partners. I have seen a lot of hands. Let's start in closest to myself.
Hi, it's Martin Lowes from Aon Hewitt. Adam is looking at, I think, the maximum value of sponsor support. And you can go about doing that in different ways, and the IORPs way is slightly different than the way that Adam was doing it. But I understand what it's trying to do. I think the next step on that the quiz looks at, and I think Craig was taking the same start point, was to look at trying to put a value on actual sponsor support rather than maximum sponsor support. And they both go about it by putting a market consistent value on a set of cash flows. And that all sounds, well, what else would you do? But actually, the set of cash flows that the quiz looks at and which Craig looked at come from absolutely nowhere. They take an assumption that you fund to buyout or technical revisions or whatever over a period. Now, that's not what's actually going to happen, unless you suddenly change the whole regime so we're funding all pension schemes to a buyout level. And it's not, so it's not the what's the cash flows that are going to happen, it's not the cash flows that could happen. So we put an awful lot of work into putting a market consistent valuation into a completely set of random numbers. And that doesn't sound to me like something you would sensibly do. You're putting an awful lot of complication around something random. It also doesn't look very holistic, because it's looking at the support from the sponsor as if it was identical to a set of payments from a bond that the pension scheme happens to hold. So it's not saying it's different from insurance because we're looking at the value of support from the sponsor and treating it differently. It's looking at a bond that's held by an insurance company and treating exactly the same. It's no more holistic than saying an insurance company can hold a bond. It's like looking at a set of insurance business and saying that we're only going to value the cash flows in and out of the asset share. If you did an insurance company like that, every insurance company would look insolvent. Mathematically, the way the quiz looks at it and the way Craig's calculations do it, the actual value of sponsor support or the value that's placed on that will never be enough except for a risk-free business. And it does seem a nonsense to put a lot of calculations to derive something that, by definition, will always be not enough.
I'll just make a couple of comments onto that. I mean, with the method that apply, it can be enough. In some cases, it's more than enough. With risky sponsors, that can come through in the calculations. But I think the more interesting point is the point I think you make about assuming away risk, if you like, here by, you know, how we assume these cash flows arise. And I think that's absolutely right. This is completely contingent on when we assume these cash flows will be paid and what circumstances they'll be paid in. And I think the reality is that a sponsor covenant, however we value it, however we analyze it, must be very, very sensitive to that. Because it's at the point at which the funds go into the pension fund that it's no longer exposed to that sponsor risk. So if that cash flow goes in next year or in 10 years' time, the riskiness of the pension fund is materially different. And where that's encapsulated by a mathematical formula or some other piece of judgment, that reality has to come through somewhere. But I think more generally, I think there is an interesting parallel here with what's been done with, say, UK with profits, where you have a very similar situation where there is a temptation, if you like, to be able to assume away risk by assuming that the company will take certain management actions which will sort the problem out in the future, and therefore the risk disappears and the need for capital disappears. And in that instance, there's been a lot of sort of governance, if you like, being put around that process, whereby the assumptions that go into these valuation models and these capital models about what actions the company, in this case a with-profit fund, not a sponsor, but I think that the similar point can apply. At what point the entity does certain actions and takes those actions is documented, and the companies held to account over time by the regulator about whether or not their actual actions are consistent with the assumptions they've made in producing these capital figures. So to some degree, I absolutely agree with your point that it's fundamental to the analysis that these assumptions are made. But I think that actuaries have gained some credibility and experience in managing that type of sensitivity and uncertainty in looking at the risk and long-term liabilities in other fields.
I saw a lot of hands.
I think I'd go along with that if the cash flows were arguably, you might pay a bit earlier, a bit later, but they're not. They're just wrong numbers. And if you start with numbers that you know are wrong, and it's not about will you take that action if that happens, that you just know they're wrong and will never happen.
Why?
Because they assume that you're paying off the buyout deficit. And that's not going to happen.
But you assume whenever you want to. So you assume whatever your cash flow policy is.
That's not what the quiz is looking at.
No, I agree with that.
But the quiz is also just, in my view, an exercise to have discussions like this and to learn from that. And I'm sure that IOPA and the European Commission is willing to listen if there is a good story to tell.
Yeah. But absolutely. I mean, the approach I would envisage working well here would be one where, at a scheme-specific level, that policy, if you like, that contribution policy is stated and specifically captured in the valuation. That's what I'm trying to capture in the framework.
And then it would
never bounce. Well, yeah, then you'd understand if you had enough or not to meet a capital requirement, yeah.
So work for social partners. A question over there.
David Kewell, Punter Southall, also introduced by the chairman as an honoured guest of the ICAW, which is a bit odd because I just sit on a subcommittee, so I better sing for my supper there. And I know they'll be saying, with due respect to the accountants already in the room, who's going to sign these things off? It's okay for the 20 clients, I'm sure PwC advise, the committee I sit on don't have those 20 clients, they have the 6,800 other clients who aren't quite as big, I suspect, and they will worry about who would sign off such a balance sheet. But as I have the microphone, I'll take my own opportunity to put in my personal comments. And like many others, I find a balance sheet that doesn't balance a bit odd. I also find a quantitative impact statement that has no impact in it also equally odd. But I do go with the chairman's view about the need for public interest, not just meaning an individual's public interest, but the public interest in a wider stake. And here we already have the PPF in play, and politically that seems to be an acceptable reduction in benefits that occurs when companies fail. The only time, in fact, we can let benefits fall is when companies fail, which adds the first very interesting point, being the trustees should never let a company fail, because it's absolutely not in the trustees' interest and the members' interest for a company to fail. So that's a great challenge, I know, to the regulator, and he's a policeman who should be looking after that world, not necessarily the trustees. The trustees have a great interest in keeping the thing going. We should have a social debate about who benefits from pensions and what they share in it. The problem is, I suspect, our world is a bit different to the Dutch world. Our world, the social debate takes place in the Daily Mail, where it's now quite clear that pension pots, which are simply a multiple of pension rights, are unacceptable. They're unacceptably big, so that's an interesting one. We also we have then the other side, of course, that transfer enhancement offers are now unacceptable, although I didn't see that being the Daily Mail's issue. I did see that be rather the advisors' issues who weren't getting paid enough for giving advice that you shouldn't transfer, but that's another issue. It would be interesting if we could trade pension rights. I mean, all these DC bill people with pots think that it's too expensive to buy pensions, and all these people with pensions would love to trade them for cash. So couldn't we work out some sort of market where they trade each other, where they'd each get the appropriate risk to be shared across each other? So I don't know that helps the debate a great bit, other than echoing the chairman's lead that actually liabilities aren't guaranteed, and that's what makes the balance sheet balance. The benefits, you can't pay 1.7 trillion pounds worth of liabilities with only 1 billion pounds of assets put aside. You can't get society to do that. So you have to move the liabilities downwards. Whatever system you look around for measuring it and observing it, they have to be ultimately reduced. And my final bit of evidence of that was a letter I received this week. My wife and I received basically the same letter. We are the same age. You could probably work this out from the comment. I received a letter that said my retirement age has gone up to 66. So did my wife. Mine only went up 1 year. Hers went up 6 years from when she started. You can't at this stage do that with private sector schemes, but you can do it in the state. It's only a matter of time.
Thank you. Very clear. There's a comment on the highest row, I think.
Gordon Sharp, KPMG. Always dangerous to try to follow Mr. Cool. One question for the panel generally, at a more prosaic level. I know you've all tried to look at practical outcomes for measurement. But I just wonder how practical it will be for a small charity with a £10 million DB scheme or another non-profit organisation with a £20-25 million DB scheme to actually go anywhere near any of the methods you're suggesting in a practical way. And one question for you, Mr. Chairman, if I may. I wonder what your stochastic projection was for the likelihood of the HBS actually coming into a revised IORP directive.
So, can you repeat the last question?
Mr. Chairman, I wonder if you had any views or comments that you could make with your GC hat on as to the likelihood of the HBS actually coming into force in a new IORP directive.
Okay. Shall I start? Well, the Groep Consultatief is very much in favor of a risk-based approach. And that is not necessarily the same as using an HBS. One of the comments that we have made is that it is unclear so far how the HBS will be used, what supervisory measures will be taken and when. And that can give a completely different picture on how you value such an approach. But the basic idea of trying to identify all the building blocks of the financial position of a pension fund and how that evolves through time is something that we do support, and that there is more knowledge about the various risks that are involved in pensions, that is a good thing. How it does work out in the end is, well, and a political matter, and that is a more general remark. I've heard it now a couple of times, what will happen if the balance doesn't balance. I think we can wait for the European Commission. Well, you will be out probably. Not sure whether I can say that. Can that be edited or? we can wait for the European Commission or a supervisor. We can also start this debating this amongst ourselves, the stakeholders of a certain pension scheme, sitting together and discussing these issues, because there is not one answer to it, I think, and there are different consequences depending on the measure that you would take. And I think, but perhaps that is also very Dutch, that you sit around the table together, discuss it, and come to a solution. And that can take a long time, but in the end, everybody needs to give in a little bit, probably, and come up with something that makes sense. And then, I think, the regulators have to follow, because all of a sudden, there is a different agreement than, or perhaps I should say, a more clarity about the agreement than there was before. And then we have to supervise this agreement. That would be, well, that is how the group thinks of it, and some of my own remarks added to that. We only have 1 or 2 minutes left, is what I've been told. So, two questions. Shinu, you already approached me before we started, so.
Thank you. Shinu Patel, and I speak as an actuary, not as a regulator, which must be a relief to all those people.
But you are working for the regulator, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, but as an actuary today, right. So my interest in this really is as a user, and I prefer to look at this on an enterprise risk basis. In other words, on a joined-up basis. So when I'm given a business value and a liability valuation, and I need to actually join those together, then I look for consistency. So the point that Kevin Westbrook made earlier was very well made, and it's worth emphasizing. There are inconsistencies in the discount rate. So does this, I wonder, open up the whole debate about what is fair value, what is a market consistent value? Should this be value based on your valuation or the value to you or the value to me? So that perhaps is a subject on its own. So we look forward to another paper from somebody. But there are other aspects of,
you're welcome,
again, joining this together. No, thank you. I don't have the competence to do that. There are other aspects which, as a user, I can make comments on of the valuation basis. When it comes to the business value, Adam, the growth rate of the company, I believe, is a critical component of that, as is the duration of the growth. Two points arise from that. One is that the growth rate itself must in some ways be linked to the inflation rate, perhaps some of the macroeconomic parameters. And those are the very same parameters that the actuary needs to take into account in assessing his liabilities. So there may be a disconnect there if unless the two are made consistent. On the duration aspect, similarly, the business valuation might just take a short-term view in the context of the view that the actuaries take, maybe 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. I doubt that it goes beyond that. The actuaries' concern is in valuing liabilities that might span 70, 80 years. And therefore, trying to capitalize, there is a danger that we basically pretend to believe that the valuation, the holistic balance sheet actually balances when it perhaps doesn't when you look at it on a time-related basis. Okay. One final comment, if I may, because I couldn't catch your eye earlier, and this was on the subject of, is two times or three times a sufficient multiple? Well, I would look at it differently. What's the purpose? It's to give you a buffer against the liabilities. So why not look at the liabilities? There is a lot of volatility in the liabilities. How about looking at the investment risk? If you've used Craig's light method, then there might be a lot of uncertainty in the measurement. So how about bringing that in? And factors like that. Now that might actually help to put some science behind that multiple, which seemed arbitrary. Thank you.
Thank you. The final person for the discussion, I guess, because we have to close after that. But the floor is yours.
Yes, Tim Webb from TW Pensions. I think the point that you raised earlier was that we need to look at what happens if you fail the holistic balance sheet. If we look at what's happened in the UK, once upon a time pensions used to be a best endeavours promise. Then someone came along and changed that down to, well, it's better to make the company insolvent than risk the members not getting their pension. And we seem to have, we're worrying about market consistent valuations, but we have a fundamental inconsistency in that the stick that we use to beat up the company is an absolute certainty that the pension will be paid. Otherwise, you can go into insolvency, but we don't have a compensation scheme which does anything more than pay about 80% overall if we can afford it in the long term. It would be lovely if we could get round the table, but I think the sceptics here will assume that we're going to be beaten up with another stick.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think the time is over, but there is still a lot to discuss, and I hope that the discussion will go on after this meeting, and we have a lot of new ingredients, I think, to this discussion. And thanks to these gentlemen to the right of me to the left for you. And yes, that is always the change. I would really like to thank you for the work that you have done. Also, Hugh Evans, I realized only late in the discussion that you were supposed to be here as well, but you have done the review, were in charge of the review of all this work. So I would like to thank you, and I would like to ask you to thank all these people who have made this possible.